Hello everyone and welcome to this webinar hosted by Toradex. The topic for today's webinar is benchmarking GPU performance of embedded Linux SoCs with Qt. And for this webinar today, we have our guests and special partners, Sequality and Qt. And let me introduce the speakers for today. My name is Janani and I'm a field application engineer at Toradex, and I will be introducing Toradex and also moderating the Q&A session at the end. And our first presenter for today is Mr. Stefan Larndorfer. He's the CEO at Sequality. If you don't know Sequality already, Sequality would be the company that will help you to succeed in your embedded projects by providing software services around embedded systems, for example, especially Qt. And our second presenter for today is Mr. Pasi Keranen. He is the senior product owner from the Qt company, which is also one of our partner companies. And Qt company is a driving company behind the Qt project. So these are our presenters. And before we dive into the webinar, please allow me to brief you on a few organizational points. In case you have some technical issues and you would want to let us know about that, please use the chat window in the webinar tool. And at the end of this webinar, we also do an interactive Q&A session. But when you have any questions already, you can type in the chat window as and when they pop, and we will pick them up at the end. And also this webinar will be recorded and will be made available for an on-demand viewing within a week from today. So with this out of our way, let's get started. So let me start with introducing Toradex. Toradex is focused on making embedded computing easy to use for everyone. That's what we're mainly focused on. And what it means for you is that our customers can get easy access to the latest technology in embedded field for their next big adventures. And how we try to accomplish this is we provide you all, our customers, with highly reliable ARM-based system on modules that comes along with software included, as well as the support. And we are striving to offer the lowest total cost of ownership to you. And this means that we do not just consider criteria like module price, but also consider other criteria like your development effort, time to market, and long-term maintenance, etc. And we're also very proud of being able to offer industry-leading support that includes very active community forum that we have, where you can type in your questions, public or anonymous, depending on your will. And then you can even have direct access to our R&D engineers. And we have also a developer page with loads of articles from getting started to even deep technical articles. And we have over 800 articles as of today, and it's being updated every day. And also, as you can see from the slide, Toradex has a global footprint. We have offices all around the world, and we also provide local support with different time zones, and we also have warehouses across the globe. And here is a short overview of our product portfolio. And this can be split into three product families. That's Apalis, Colibri, and our very new member of the family, Verdin, which we are super excited about. Verdin was launched at the beginning of this year and already features two SOMs in the family based on IMX8M. And also an interesting fact about Toradex SOMs is that each of the modules within the family are pin compatible. So for example, you can seamlessly scale from IMX6 over to IMX7 or IMX8, as long as it's within the same family, for example, Colibri, and also as long as you follow the standard pinout from Toradex. And we also provide a production quality software that's shipped along with these modules. And here I would also like to introduce our focus applications, because we are constantly trying to optimize our products and offerings to suit the most of our customer needs. And the areas we primarily focus on are industrial automation, medical and laboratory equipments, and we are big also in test and measurement, and retail and ticketing, transportation, etc. And our typical product or typical projects or our typical customers are ones with the volumes that range from 100 pieces or 100 products per year until up to 50K products per year. And Toradex itself has thousands of active customers at this moment. So we're almost at the end of introduction to Toradex. I would like to also talk briefly about Torizon here. Torizon is a brand new offering from Toradex. It's an open source and easy to use industrial Linux platform. It focuses on lowering your time to market and can be used out of box. Toradex has a new project called Torizon Platform, where we try to improve the time to market for our customers. As you can see, the project is open source. It's based on Yocto, and it uses Docker containers for customer applications. We even developed extensions for Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code, which help you to start developing on Torizon. And also some of our partners provide containers for Torizon and that include their own software stack. So with this introduction to Toradex, I now hand over to Sequality, Stefan, to take over the presentation.
Hello, everybody. I'm Stefan Landorfer from Sequality Software in Austria. As already introduced, we're a service consulting company around embedded Linux applications. So most of the part, it's dealing with embedded Linux C++, Qt, and HTML5-based applications. And over the last year, we've developed the benchmarkings for GPU. And the results of these benchmarks I want to go through with you today. Before I go into the agenda and the next bullets, let me also shortly have an overview of what Sequality does. So our main focus is in providing embedded Linux-based applications most of our customers are in the automotive or in the industry sector. We have also quite a few that produce small devices, medical devices, or other convenient devices that run embedded Linux and Qt and HTML5-based applications on it in order to realize user interface or the system features in general. And in order to do this, closely work together with hardware vendors and module vendors like Toradex. Here in the middle of the screen, you can see an IMX6 module. So this is basically right now the standard hardware platform that we are working with. I would say more than 70% of our customers use exactly an NXP IMX6 processor. This has several reasons, but we'll come to that later again. So today, those are the points that I will follow through my presentation. First, I would like to make clear that we all have the same impression on the software stack that the GPU benchmark runs. So as you know, with Qt, you can have different versions, or you can target for different applications. We will go through this the first. And I will tell you a short story about how we came about developing the GPU benchmark, and then, of course, the benchmark results, and at the end, some references and links. There will also be a short video that I will play where you can see live impressions, how smooth it is when it runs on a specific hardware. As already mentioned, with Qt, you can build a wide range of applications on different targets with different performance requirements. About a good half year ago, there was a new offering from Qt, Qt for microcontrollers. So you can also run Qt on microcontrollers now without embedded Linux as an operating system. And if you move up a little bit and you use small embedded processors like an IMX6 UL, this processor has a powerful CPU but no hardware support for rendering OpenGL. So you would most likely end up with using Qt with a software renderer where the CPU renders all of the graphics on the display. On the image above on this slide here, so this is a small IMX6 UL development board with a display that uses this software renderer. And the next point in blue, Qt on embedded Linux with EGLFS plugin. This is, we would say, a typical usage of Qt on an embedded device that also has support for rendering OpenGL on the hardware. And this will also be more or less the platform that we have decided to run our benchmark on. So all that we speak today will not focus the performance of Qt for microcontrollers or Qt with software render. We'll just more or less be talk about Qt on embedded Linux with eGLFS renderings. The last point, of course, you can also use Qt in standard desktop hardware running Windows or Ubuntu or whatever Linux distribution you favor. On the right-hand side here, you can see already a small impression of the software that we used for our embedded GPU benchmark. It's the Sequality Automotive suite. One short recap on the Qt on embedded Linux with eGLFS. So how does the software stack look like? On the right-hand side, you have a very simple visualization of this. Of course, you have your hardware, and on top of this hardware, the embedded Linux kernel runs, and above it, the eGLFS plugin is used in order to access the OpenGL graphics drivers and render graphics with hardware support. And the yellow box probably then is your Qt application that you implement. And you have to know that with eGLFS, there's no window manager. So when you want to realize a dual screen application, you have to deal somehow with this limitation. So in our case, we used two separate embedded Linux boards to drive each display. So just to keep this in mind. And we used exactly this software stack with boot to Qt 5.14. And in some cases with the lower end IMX6, we used 5.13.2 because there were issues with 5.14. We did those benchmark in April 2020. So those were the latest boot to Qt versions that we had available. Right now, there is, of course, already a newer one, but this was the boot to Qt version that was used. Yeah, so now a few words about the Sequality Automotive suite that was the basis for the embedded GPU benchmark. So I think it's important that you know how this software is set up, because if you're using a similar application, you can compare the benchmark results quite well. And of course, if your application is set up in a completely different way, you might again benchmark your application on the hardware in order to get a good comparison here in terms of hardware performance. But yeah, what did we use in our application? We heavily make use of full HD 2D graphics. Quite big areas are transparent, and we also use opacity masks that we use in Qt Quick. And there are some animations also in Qt Quick that we implemented there. And yeah, it's a dual screen setup, but we only used the left cockpit screen, so the instrument cluster was used for the benchmark. The infotainment system on the right hand side was not included in the benchmark. We used a navigation system. It's realized with Mapbox GL. This is also a plugin that very well integrated in the Qt framework. Yeah, so this navigation system uses 3D vectors to render maps, and also you can even render buildings with this. And yeah, basically the Qt open source edition was used for all the benchmarks and also for this application. But of course, it would also run the same way with the commercial edition. It would not make any difference. And for this suite, we designed the components by ourselves. We did not use additional tools like Qt 3D or Qt Design Studio to realize the solution. There's a link below. So if you want to have a look on our website, there's also a video about this whole suite, how it works, and what you can do with it. Yeah, in terms of hardware selection, about a year ago, we had a hard time when we first realized that our automotive solution doesn't really run well on the IMX6. We even thought, okay, maybe we do something wrong, where there's some bottleneck somewhere in the software. but as we tried it also out on a Raspberry Pi 3 that we also had available in our office, we found out, okay, it doesn't perform there well as well. So then thought, okay, we need something more powerful along this path, and we wanted to make sure that we also include the successor of the IMX6 in terms of graphics performance. For us, it is the IMX8. So NXP IMX8 Quad Max and NXP IMX8X Quad X Plus, we thought would be very interesting hardware platforms to compare in terms of performance. We also tried to include NVIDIA modules, the TK1 and T30 modules that are also available from Toradex. But yeah, unfortunately, we ran into a few issues with the Mapbox GL plugin there. Yeah, probably it would have been possible to get it up and running, but at the time constraints that we were facing to do the benchmark, it was this time a little bit too much work for us, and so we were not able to really have a good comparison here. So they were not part of the benchmark, so the lineup, so you can see here on the very left, there's an IMX6 Colibri module, then there's an IMX6 quad-core Apelles module, a Raspberry Pi 3, an IMX8X on an Colibri module already installed, a Raspberry Pi 4, and the IMX8 on an Apelles board, also with a heatsink and a fan because it really needs it. Yeah, so this was basically the hardware selection for our benchmark in the first. Of course, we also want to make sure that our benchmark is not bottlenecked by something else. So we really took apart our application and had a look where we could optimize it, and so that we really measure the GPU performance and are not limited by another factor. So how we did it, what is now on this slide, the first thing that we did was we more or less excluded big parts of the application commented out big sections until there was basically a black screen empty. And with this approach, we were able to find a few spots that really were worth looking at and that are really hard to find if you're just using performance analysis tools. Then of course it was very important to add measuring tools and measuring figures in order to measure how good the performance actually right now is. So the frames per second counter was added, and we also had a close look on CPU load and other monitoring figures of the embedded Linux board. Then, and understanding the Qt Quick Scene Graph renderer is also a very crucial factor in order to be able to optimize the application. There's a very good documentation, the Qt framework, about this. It's the first link. It's also a good presentation from a Qt World Summit event about this. So our developers, they really could benefit a lot and optimize it a lot. Of course, then we also had a look at the performance analysis tools that are available within the Qt framework, overdraw analysis, batch analysis, and the flame graph. And those three tools, I want to give you a short overview how we use them in order to further improve their performance. Third thing was to do an overdraw analysis. So on the top, you can see our software solution, so the instrument cluster that we wanted to optimize. And below, you can see in the bigger image, you can see the overdraw analysis live in action. So if you're really executing this application, you can even interact with the application. And as you switch the screens, you get a live update view of this overdraw analysis. And maybe you already have tried this out. It's a really interesting view because you really see how your software is composed, how the layers are stacked on top of each other, and how clipping and occlusion detection could be improved. And yeah, so this is a very interesting way to see at your application. And more or less what you want to do is to optimize the visible properties of your Qt Quick elements, because the important thing to know here is that Qt Quick doesn't have an automatic occlusion detection. So it does not automatically know which parts are visible and which parts are not visible. And it also renders the parts by default that are not visible. And this, of course, consumes GPU resources. And you can optimize this by putting the visible property here to false and give the renderer here hints how to effectively render the whole scene. So was a very important part of optimizing it. Also the batch analysis, which basically gives you an answer to the question, which parts are rendered in one shot. And the fewer colors that you have here on this image, the fewer shots it needs to render the whole scene. And yeah, there's a rule of thumb here. It's I think I copied it out of the Qt documentation. Batches should be fewer than 10, and at least 3 or 4 of them should be opaque. So there you get a rule of thumb how many batches you have. You haven't actually counted them here, but it looks like that we had about 10 here in this image. And the batch analysis. And last but not least, the flame graph. It's more or less a visualization of the call stack of your application during runtime, and gives you an answer how long each call takes, how long it is executed. The more you go up on this flame graph, the more likely it is that you. On the top, there are the user functions, and if you have a very long user function on the top of such a hill, this is probably a good spot to optimize your application. Have a look at this function. Good. After all those analysis and searches for bottlenecks, we did this optimizations presented on this slide. So the first thing that we found out that there was actually a part that consumed quite a lot of CPU powers, and this was the root simulation. So more or less by accident, we found out this because the first routes that we tested on our system were from Berlin to Linz, where more or less we are located. This is a route that is about 600 kilometers. Yeah, it contains a lot of GPS points along this 600 kilometer path that the CPU has to simulate and deliver to the application so that actual position can be simulated. And this, of course, we didn't want to have this kind of CPU load. We optimized the C++ container that delivers those GPS coordinates with additional caching. And we also said, okay, we have to test always the same route for the GPU benchmark, and we will take a short route for the GPU benchmark in order not to be limited by the CPU power, because obviously we want to test the GPU, not the CPU here. So we ended up having a short route inside Berlin for our GPU benchmarks. The next thing that we also found out was somehow interesting for us is to have variations in the benchmark setups. Somehow interesting that we got different figures whether we used 2D maps or 3D maps in our navigation system. And we did different versions of this GPU benchmark with different settings. We even included then a version where we got rid of all the images and all the navigation system parts, and we rendered just text and labels here. The third thing was to activate caching of the application so that parts that are not changed are cached and that they are automatically renewed if there are changes. Also improved performance. We had a look at the Qt Quick Compiler and tried it out, but we found out that more or less as soon as the application is up and running, there was no difference between using the compiler or not using the compiler for us. It only increased the startup performance of the application. And yeah, as you might already see, there are not that many Qt Quick objects on this scene. So this was only a rather small increase in the startup performance here. So we ended up not really using the Qt Quick compiler here for the GPU benchmark. It was okay already without. The background color was also a topic that we optimized. There, I think, are a few hints also in the Qt documentation how to efficiently render the background color. It's a relatively small change in the code, but has a huge effect on the rendering performance. We were very astounded about this. And last but not least, the visible property. I already mentioned this in the overdraw analysis. So we optimized this to get better performance as well. And as we started with this GPU benchmark, and I already mentioned that the first thing somehow was really to take the application apart, to start more or less with a black screen and have a look at the frames per second of a black screen on the devices. And this somehow already was interesting because we found out, okay, the iMac 6 isn't really able to render 60 frames per second, even if you have an empty application. So this somehow set already the frame. What kind of results can we expect here? And then we added just the background image. So this was the second step that we did. And we found out, okay, the iMac 6 quad core here already drops from 60 to 30 frames just by adding the background image. Those are the yellow figures here. And if we added a second background image on top of this, the frames again dropped. And this somehow was a strange thing for us, something new that we didn't knew before, that just static images somehow cause frame drops. I think we already had a few conversations with Toradex about this, and probably there are some limitations in terms of memory bandwidth here. But we took this information for us and said, okay, we really need to optimize the images that we use in the application. On the right-hand side, you can see a few layers of, I think it's Photoshop, that we then somehow merged together, and we made sure that the images are as small as possible, and that whenever you can merge down manually images, that we did this, and this helped to improved in performance for especially the smaller processes a lot. And as you could also see here in this table, iMX 8 or the Raspberry Pi 4, they did not have those issues, but iMX 6 mainly they profit from this optimization quite a lot. And the next thing concerning images was to optimize transparency and the opacity mask. So in some cases, we used the opacity mask instead of the image alpha channel in order to realize the same appearance in the application. There is probably it could be even done in a more efficient way, we somehow had to deal there with some limitations also how you can configure opacity mask. But all in all, having a look at transparencies and maybe exchanging them for opacity mask here even also improved performance and were useful for us to improve the situation. Good. Now I can give you a short overview of the benchmark results and also an impression how well the application performs when I play back the video. So let me just switch to the video view.
Hello, everybody. This is Stefan Landhofer from Sequality. This time, I want to give you an update on our embedded Linux GPU benchmark results. This time, we also have results for the IMX8 X. So the IMX8 X is the smaller brother of the bigger IMX8 Quad Max. So to put this into perspective, this one has a dual Vivantic graphics GC7000, and this one has a single graphics Vivante GC7000 Lite. So let's come to the benchmark results. All in all, it really performs very well. So as you can see here, in most scenarios, the IMX 8X is even faster than the Raspberry Pi 4. And it really has very, very nice performance. And only a small, there's only a small performance gap to the IMX 8 and a relatively huge improvement to the IMX 6 quad core. So, but what does this mean in terms of user experience when you're using such an embedded CPU? So for this, here we have prepared two displays. This bottom display is run by the IMX 8X. And the top display is connected to the IMX 6 quad core. So here we have about 30 frames per second, and on the top we have about 13 frames per second. So now I'll just use the display a little bit and give an impression. So here we are in Berlin. So here on the IMX 8X, you really can interactively use this very smooth. It's very smooth, even with a lot of objects on the screen. It's a smooth and pleasant experience. And in comparison here to the IMX 6, you even recognize on the video here that it's a little bit stuttering when you interact with it. The screen doesn't immediately follow your finger. Zooming is not so smooth. And the overall user experience is not so good. And especially if you zoom out, it's even harder to render. So there's no headroom. Then the frames drop really dramatically. And if you want to move it, you see that's not a pleasant user experience. And here it's still smooth. So this really pays off, this extra performance. To put this into perspective, we also want to show you how this works here on this system. So I'll restart the root now. So here we can also put it like that. We are using an Intel Nuke i3 with Intel integrated graphics that is rendering the graphics for both displays. Those are both full HD displays. And both displays have 60 frames per second, no matter what I do here. So it's really a very smooth experience, even smoother as with 30 frames per second. It's the ideal frame rate, of course. And in terms of load, we here have about 55% of the GPU. So there's still a lot of headroom left. And so you get the idea of the performance differences between the IMX8, IMX8X, the IMX6 quad core, and an Intel integrated Iris Pro graphics. So this was it for today. Thank you very much. See you next time. Bye.
So hello again. This was an impression between IMX 6 and IMX 8X. So now we can go through the benchmark results in detail again. We mainly focused on 720p and full HD, so 1080p resolution. And from the modes, we had idle mode or navigating mode. Idle means, okay, we're just rendering speed and RPM, but there was no navigation in progress. And with navigating, there's also the route simulated and the maps render. Good. So those are the results of the very first version of our cluster that was unoptimized. So the initial version without optimizations. As you can see here, the Raspberry Pi 3 was not really able to deliver good results, and the IMX 6, we were below 10 frames, so mostly 5, 6, 7 frames per second. We are reached only in the idle, in the 720p idle, we had above 10. So this is not a good result here on our initial version. Only the IMX 8 somehow barely managed to reach 20 frames per second in the full HD screen. So the next results were done just with the image optimization. So there was no code changed here, so no code optimizations. Only the images were optimized so that images were manually merged, and the resource management of the application in Qt was optimized. There were no images loaded that were not actually needed. And with this, we could already improve the situation quite a bit. So you see that the IMX 8 at 720p and even full HD in the idle mode, they reached 60 frames per second, which is the ideal frame rate. And even the IMX 6 and the Raspberry Pi 3, they benefited a lot from this improvement here, and was already somehow usable at the Raspberry Pi 3 with about 20 frames per second, just with the image optimization here. The next step, you can see the results of the fully optimized version of this instrument cluster. So with all the overdraw analysis and visible properties and caching and so on, all the optimizations were done here on this version. And now the bigger IMX 8 was above 40 frames per second. So really very smooth experience already. And for us, it was very interesting to see that all in all, the IMX 8X really also had a very good performance, almost as good as the Raspberry Pi 4, or almost the same performance, I would say. And this is very good news for us, because a lot of our customers right now are thinking about somehow moving up to the bigger NXP chip, more or less. And so this is good news here on this from this side. Raspberry Pi 4 as good as the IMX 8X, and the Raspberry Pi 3, of course, has a little smaller graphics chip on it, was behind the Raspberry Pi 4. And then there came the IMX 6 quad core that has a little better graphics chip than the IMX 6 Dual Lite. And then we did a variation. We exchanged Mapbox GL, and we took Mapbox with 2D images, with raster images. So Mapbox 2D uses images, raster images, to render the map. And here we somehow found out that this version really does not really perform better than the Mapbox GL. So if we compare the two slides here, you can even see that most of the bars are lower here. And we don't really actually know why it is, but probably it's because of this image problem that we also found out. So this would mean that images, that's so big amounts of images, are probably harder to render than complex 3D scenes for the GPU. But of course, we don't really know it in detail what really the problem is. But it did not really perform better than the Mapbox GL here. So then, yeah, in this version of the instrument cluster, we stripped out the navigation system of the instrument cluster and just had the speed and RPMs visualize during executing a route. And so here we just wanted to make sure that, okay, it performs well even on an IMX6, and this was confirmed by this test. So the IMX6 quad core reached 30 frames per second, and this is also the same frames that it reached when we just added one black background image. So somehow the IMX6 quad core never reached 60 frames per second on a full HD display. So this is obviously somehow the maximum it can get in full HD. And here you also can see that the GPU of the IMX6 quad core performs a little better than the IMX6 dual light. Yeah, it's a relatively small, I think, difference between those two GPU modules, but here you can see it in this benchmark. Then there was one version without any images at all, just to see how this performs. And if you compare this version against the fully optimized version with everything, there's only very little change. So this meant, okay, in the optimized version, the additional images don't really have a lot of overhead. So we're good here in this at this part. And there was also a version without any images at all, despite the small little icons on the top. But of course, here, when we are rendering just text and labels, we reached 30 frames per second on the IMX6 dual light. And on 720p, the IMX6 quad core even reached 60 frames, but again, on full HD, only 30 frames. Good. This is just a summary of the results, and all in all, I would say if you want to have a high resolution application, I think you should have a look at really a hardware that is more powerful than an IMX6, and IMX8X probably is already then a good way to go, and as these chips always deliver performance at about 30 frames. And yeah. Good. This is almost the end of my presentation. Some future work. So we are planning to automate getting the benchmark results of the GPU benchmarking tool. It's still a work in progress here, but probably there will be something available in the future to compare GPUs on embedded SoCs. And probably there will also even be a kind of Yocto layer, but we'll see. What is already available right now is an embedded system monitor that we also used in this scenario. So let me just shortly show you where you can get this. Here you can see the an overview of the automotive demo that we used here for the benchmark. Again, a video about impressions, how this works, and how it's used. And the system monitor probably also is a very handy tool to monitor your embedded solution. You can either run it in a web browser on your embedded device or just on your smartphone where you connect to your embedded device and monitor it just with the browser on your phone or, of course, on your desktop. Good. then I would say, yeah, this was it. I think we already mentioned this summary. And thank you for your attention. I think now it's time to hand over to Parsi that will introduce you to the next topic here.
Hello. So continuing from Stefan's presentation, I have worked several years in the graphics and UI industry, both before and during QT. And I can attest that the selecting the right hardware is really important for your use case. So when we were now launching this new 3D technology, QT Quick 3D, we were really considering how to help customers with this. Let me first introduce QT Quick 3D really quickly, as it's a new technology for us. Some of you may have heard about our QT 3D Studio technology, which was our first step in integrating the 3D rendering technology we received as a contribution from NVIDIA. It was good. It had a good editor, and it has a good runtime, really well optimized runtime. And it had a lot, but the biggest problem we had with that was the initial integration was just as a big module that is visible in the QML. So in the QML, you would have this one massive big QML element that then loaded the XML. That then was the presentation. So this meant that for the programmer's view, there was these two domains. So there was the QML that had only some top level controls on top of the presentation. And then also whenever you wanted to change the presentation, you always needed to go through the editor. And of course, for designers, this is the thing that they want to do. But for programmers who are debugging performance issues, this is often not the most efficient way to go. Also, this was one issue that we ran into was that there are many times use cases where you want to combine both the artist-generated 3D content and programmer-generated, what we call data-driven 3D content. So for example, if you want to have a car model in your cluster and that is generated by the artist and design how it behaves and how it looks, but then you need to surround it with some sensory information, for example, that comes from all different data sources. That's a good use case where the old integration didn't work so well. So we have now gone a step further and we have broken down basically the NVIDIA technology into smaller pieces that we can then integrate directly into the QT Quick rendering engine itself. And this also helps in the sense that no longer the 3D is a totally separate pipeline running with its own resource control. And then you have QT Quick as a separate thing. Now they are all merged together, which means that this is a much more efficient way of doing combined rendering of 2D and 3D, which is most often the use case. You want to have still 2D UI elements, especially on the 2D screens. And as was visible from Stefan's presentation, we are fully open source. So customers have full source code access. And this many times has helped even in the past and probably is going to help us in the future in the cases where you need to go really deep and try to understand how the system works and then optimize your content for that. But as I said, we wanted this time around help customers before you have selected the hardware. So help you gauge the hardware performance of your expected use cases. So for this, we have developed a QT Quick 3D benchmarking application. And that allows you to basically offers a different point of view from what Sequality is offering. So Sequality, the benchmark Stefan presented, it approaches this problem space from a point of view of specific use cases that you might want to implement and then runs those on top of QT and offers you a perspective like, okay, this type of a use case might run at this rate on this hardware. Our benchmark offers a different point of view. So for the new 3D API, so we provide a benchmarking application to test the features of the API. And also, as you can see from Stefan's presentation as well, from the navigation view, how much the performance differed when you change the content of the navigation view and how actually one thing that might seem like an optimization was actually not an optimization. So I always consider it that in especially when you go to 3D, the content is king, and how your content matches the performance profile of your chosen hardware, that then defines your end user experience. So our new benchmarking application basically allows you to select the number of models that is visible on the screen. It allows you to then select what is the fidelity of the model, basically how many polygons are there from various options. It allows you to select how many lights there are. It allows you to play around with the texture size, what kind of material shading you are using, what are kind of anti-aliasing methods or post-processing effects you want to try out. And basically by doing this, it allows you to play around with this and figure out what hardware would be the best fit for your planned content. So I have a short video showing this in action. Just a second. So here you can see that the model is not probably anything that any of you want to show in your application, but the whole idea is that this is a representative data. So here you can see you can change the number of models, you can see change the fidelity of the models. For example, now it's like 50K polygons. You can play around with the different effects that are in there. And the whole idea is that by doing these selections, you get some level of confidence in that the content that you are planning to run on the device, the performance should be then what you expect out of it. I'll assume so here are some of the post-processing effects that you can use. These are at this point quite still early stages, I would say, but they are something you can use. We are planning to add more of these in the future, obviously, but yes, as I said, the content is king, so you need to be able to try out facsimile content on the hardware that you're choosing as soon as possible, and that way you get more confidence on will you be able to implement your specific use case on that hardware. Now, if I switch over back to my presentation, the benchmarking application, it is available, it is open source, so you can get it today. So here's the link. This will be hopefully posted also in the comment section of the video that shows you the blog introduces the benchmarking application, and that blog has a link to the Git repository where you can get this benchmark application from also. And in the future, as I said, we are planning to add more post-processing effects, but also the biggest thing that we are now working with Qt 6 is that we are introducing also a new rendering hardware interface. So what this allows you to do is transparently use Vulkan, DirectX 12, OpenGL, Metal, and so on as the rendering technology underneath the whole graphics stack. And this applies to both 2D and 3D. So OpenGL ES support is still there and it works really well, as OpenGL is here today. What we see is that it is clearly the future in the embedded systems, and I believe already supported by the latest Toradex hardware as well. And it's really interesting that we have already tried out the Vulkan rendering, and we weren't expecting in the 2D cases that much of a benefit from using Vulkan, but we were pleasantly surprised that actually by using Vulkan, we can actually lower the CPU usage, which is in many use cases desirable, either from heat management or battery management point of view. But also when you switch over to Vulkan, especially on the 3D side, what we are definitely seeing is improved performance. So we have this already running in our own builds. And you probably have noticed that if you are following our mailing list, that the Qt 6 first snapshots are now starting to be available. And of course, it's still early stages, but they will be improving when we go into the future. And we are still working on optimizing the 2D and 3D mixed cases, especially on the embedded side. We are also looking at how to optimize our effects more, even to make them even more feasible to run on the embedded, and especially how to combine more effects on the embedded space. We are also researching a 3D particle system that we also are aiming to be available on the embedded systems. So yeah, Qt Quick 3D, we believe is going to be the future of 3D in Qt, and we hope that the benchmarking application also helps you early on, before you have even, you know, selected your hardware, to pick the right hardware for your needs. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Stefan and Pasi, for a very interesting presentation. We have quite some time now, and so we will move on now to the Q&A session. So first question would be for Stefan. So the question is, how did you cache static images to optimize performance? For your optimizations and tweaking images, you said like you had static images from Photoshop that got merged, and yeah, they want to know if you have optimized those static images.
So basically what we did is that whenever it was possible to merge image layers in the image program manually and use the combined merged image in the application, we did this. On our initial version, we got an export of our UI designer, where we got more or less each Photoshop layer individually, and we had, I think, 4 or 5 layers stacked on top of each other. And there were many cases, especially with static content, where we could merge those images down into the background, for instance. Yeah. And when we optimized the images here, we made sure that all of the pixels that we could merge down to the background, more or less, are really merged down to the background. And also that whenever we did not really need an image where we could use static color, or yeah, where we could shrink down the image size, that this was done here as well. So those were the main two things that were optimized here.
Perfect. So another question on the same thing. They wanted to know, how do you do caching?
I think there is an option in the Qt Quick application to enable this caching on the Qt Quick side. So it's within the Qt Quick application that you can activate this here. I think you can look this also up in the documentation of Qt. So it's not a feature that we implemented by ourselves. It's more or less a standard thing that you can activate and use within your Qt Quick component.
Perfect, thank you. So, another question again to you is, frame per second, the main criteria for benchmarking?
For this benchmark, yes, it was the main criteria. Of course, we also had a look at other figures, at the CPU load and also memory. And we just wanted to make sure that we are not bottlenecked here at other resources, so that the CPU load is inside reasonable figures. And then we just had a look at the frames per second, as it is the immediate, I would say, measurement that can also be recognized by the human eye. I think we could also even see it in the video when there were very low frames. Even that my camera that I used for filming could capture the flickering of the screen as so the frames per second were the main focus where we focused on our measurements.
Perfect, thank you. So we're quite over time here, so we have like one last question. So that question would be, what criteria did you have when you chose your hardware for this benchmarking?
The criteria, more or less, for us was, I would say most of our customers, they many of our projects nowadays use the IMX6 chips right now. So somehow for us, the question was, okay, what is the successor of the IMX6 in terms of CPU and graphics performance? And somehow we wanted to give our customers an answer. Is the IMX8 a suitable successor to this? and which other platforms might be interesting to have a look on. So really, unfortunately, the NVIDIA modules, we could not get them up and running in the time frame that we had for preparing this GPU benchmark. They would be an interesting comparison platform. But this obviously somehow also is due to the fact that the drivers of the IMX6, they are most of them are all mainline, and with NVIDIA we had to run a different build system, and we ran into a few issues that we did not have to solve with the IMX6 or IMX8 lineup. So unfortunately, we did not manage to include them there. And of course, in terms of Raspberry Pi, it's also always interesting to somehow use hardware that more or less is generally available, that you have a comparison in terms of performance. And for us, it also was very interesting how good the graphics of an IMX6 and an IMX8 is compared to an Intel Iris Pro graphics from an Intel Nuke. So I think this was done in the GPU benchmark, and there are some results there. And for us, this was very interesting findings here, and we were quite happy with the hardware selection, I would say, and also happy that the Raspberry Pi 4 finally also managed to get inside the benchmark, because a year ago there were almost no OpenGL drivers available, and I think with Boot to Qt 5.14 they also released an image for Raspberry Pi 4, which saved the day for us here.
Perfect. Thank you for the detailed explanation, Stefan. And I think we have no more questions at this moment. So I really thank you so much again, Stefan and Pasi, for a very interesting presentation. And I also thank all the participants for attending this webinar. And I wish you have a very great day ahead. And then I wish you a nice weekend later. Thank you.